Welcome back to World Crisis Radio. When Karzai can tell the U.S. this is your last warning, when he's got about a quarter of a million U.S. NATO mercenary forces in the country, it indicates the weakness of the empire and, indeed, the strength of the Chinese alternative. Another straw in the wind, Union Bank of Switzerland, UBS, has downgraded the stock of Family Dollar, one of these very cheap dollar stores that people turn to when they're unemployed and approaching destitution. It turns out that had been a very prosperous category in 2008, 2009. Now UBS says they're downgrading that stock, no longer a buy, just a hold. So you have all this going on. The progress of the destabilization, always useful to look back to 1848, which is, I think, a relevant to historical comparison. The entire process in 1848 tended to go into reverse by June, July of that year. Started in January, started way south, Sicily, Tunisia, not that far apart. By June 12th, you had the Austrian general Windischgrätz essentially reconquering Prague, subduing Prague, reconquering it, kicking out the Pan-Slavic Conference with the famous Czech historian Palatsky, I believe, the dominant figure. So that's Windischgrätz, north of the Alps. South of the Alps, it's Radetzky, who defeats the Piedmontese army under King Carlo Alberto at Custozza, July 25th, 1848. And, of course, the central one, the Paris June days, the 24th to the 26th of June, the attempt by the bourgeoisie to crush the national workshops. And after that, it's essentially there are no more advances. I think we're reaching some kind of a turning point here, and I think that is spreading as despair in the Anglo-American ruling elite. A couple of other things to bear in mind. The continuing attacks on Ahmadinejad in Iran, and we'll have to wonder, who is inspiring these? Could it be MI6, for example? The Majlis, the parliament, is attacking Ahmadinejad for his oil industry policies. And, of course, he had been clashing with the top mullahs in the country. Ahmadinejad, of course, the only one elected by all the people. Say what you will, he won an election. And if you're talking democratic legitimacy, that's usually what they say. But somehow not for Ahmadinejad. They know in their hearts that he didn't win the election, that it was really Karoubi and the golden youth of Tehran North. So all of that happening. Let us now consider, we had the U.S. congressional by-election the previous week, and this, of course, all turned on Medicare. And it reminds us once again that the American people, this is New Deal Nation, this is the American people who absolutely support Social Security and Medicare. Based on those polls, it's something like 75% of people, because just about everybody figures they're going to live to have Social Security and Medicare. Medicaid, they don't quite understand it. The support levels are 5 or 6 points lower because they don't realize that they may need Medicaid to pay for nursing home care if they don't want to completely bankrupt their own families. And then unemployment benefits, some people kid themselves, they're not going to be unemployed, and similarly for the other things. But generally, this is New Deal America. And the reactionaries, as we've said, come down to 15 to 20%. They are a lunatic fringe. The people who are interested in the Austrian school and the Chicago school, who are mobilizable by the Tea Party at this point, who think that the Koch brothers are national benefactors, and so on, that's about 15 to 20%. It hasn't changed that much, which is remarkable. Despite the betrayals of Obama, despite those decades of constant ranting propaganda from the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and the Koch brothers, and so on. Therefore, the Republicans lose this extremely Republican district. Now, however, beware. The concern of the American people are to keep the entitlements the way they are. The Republicans, with Ryan, have unwisely come out and saying, we are determined to destroy the New Deal entitlements. Your economic rights will be stripped, and we will go towards Pottersville, right, in the famous movie It's a Wonderful Life, right? Powdersville, when the bankers take over the place that, you know, the society collapses and crime and prostitution and narcotics and social destruction are everywhere. They want Powdersville. The Democrats, of course, say, well, we'll reform Medicare. Yeah, they'll do it with death panels, right? The Republicans kill you with the market. The Democrats kill you with bureaucratic death panels. The Independent Payment Advisory Board, IPAB, is the chosen vehicle there. The people want jobs. The Democrats say, we'll give you green jobs, meaning no jobs at all, subsidized boondoggles that are anti-economic. And the Republicans, of course, they said, jobs, jobs, jobs. They're not delivering on that either. They're interested in the deficit, the debt, and their other ideological Austrian school obsessions. So what you're left with is an entire political establishment, be they Republican or Democrat, who are absolutely hostile to the real concerns of the American people. Now, that's a political crisis. The monetarists on the one side, the Malthusians on the other, and the masses who don't get anywhere with any of that. One interesting thing about that district where the Democrat finally won, Hochul, up there in New York State, that was a Republican district for a very long time. And one of the congressmen that represented that district was Congressman Hamilton Fish. Hamilton Fish, this is a family, right? There were guys named Hamilton Fish going back, you know, 150 years ago in that area. But the interesting one is the Hamilton Fish, who was around in the early 1940s, was one of the reactionary Republicans who was most distinguished for hatred of Franklin D. Roosevelt. And this Hamilton Fish was also distinguished by the fact that he was widely accused of being a Nazi sympathizer. And in the interesting book, The Nazi Hydra in America, we find a report by a guy called Maloney, who was working for the Department of Justice at the time. And he found that there were several members of Congress of the United States who in that 1940, 41, 42 were actually Nazi collaborators. And one of the people on this list was Hamilton Fish, along with some others. There were largely Republicans, but there also were a few Democrats. No way around it. Burton Wheeler, Democrat of Montana, was thought to be at least a useful idiot for the propaganda of Nazi Germany. So Hamilton Fish, and of course the interesting thing is Hamilton Fish had a guy working in his mail room, again in the Nazi Hydra. Hamilton Fish had a guy working in the mailroom by the name of George Hill, and the report is that George Hill was actually indicted. They couldn't go after Hamilton Fish because he was a big fish, but the little fish, George Hill, was indicted for collaboration with the Nazis. Now, that was September 1941. Now, that's pre-Pearl Harbor, but already violating federal laws. Hamilton Fish then went on to write one of the first big ranting books attempting to blame Franklin D. Roosevelt for Pearl Harbor. So that's a very, very interesting reminder. So that district where that guy could be congressman for all those years has now pitched out of the hands of the Republicans and into the hands of the Democrats. But don't celebrate too soon, because that is not getting us out of the crisis. The Democrats are equally determined to destroy Obama in particular. Obama is determined to destroy the New Deal reforms. He is the anti-Franklin D. Roosevelt, wants to destroy Social Security. He's the anti-John F. Kennedy, as you can see in this case with Moody's, S&P, and Fitch, right? Kennedy fought Roger Blau. Obama kowtows to these people. And he's the anti-LBJ, because the Medicare, of course, is under attack. On the Kennedy one, we should also remember we're now approaching the end of the U.S. manned spaceflight program with the last shuttle launch. That is called national suicide, and that has got to be rolled back. So we'll be continuing to fight it out along that line, and we'll be back with that next week on World Crisis Radio. In the meantime, keep up with Tarpley.net. And keep up with Webster G. Tarpley, all one word, on the Twitter account. See you next week.